Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. From our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum in New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. It's the holiday season on Louisiana Eats, and this week our spirits are high. High proof, that is. As you prepare for your festivities, we're going to get you in the spirit with some of the world's most renowned cocktailians, starting with cocktail industry wonder boy, Dave Wondrich. Dave's reported from the front lines of the craft cocktail movement since its earliest days and is considered to be one of the world's top cocktail historians and writers. And when it comes to history, Tom Bulleit's got quite a tale. Tom's great-great-grandfather, Augustus Bulleit's bourbon, is the stuff of legends. Just prior to the Civil War, Augustus died while transporting barrels of his Kentucky whiskey to New Orleans, and his legendary bourbon died with him. Luckily, he left behind a recipe that Tom Bulleit used to create his own legendary spirit, Bulleit Bourbon. So you deck the halls, and we'll make your spirits bright on this week's Louisiana Eats.
One, two, check, check, check.
We say, instead of testing, we say tasting.
Well, I can drink to that. My name is David Wondrich. I'm a drinks writer and the senior drinks columnist at the Daily Beast.
Over the years, we've talked to dozens of cocktail experts on Louisiana Eats, and I've noticed that their faces light up when they start to talk about a certain magical moment in the industry's history. At the turn of the 21st century, bartenders began to rediscover the old ways of mixing drinks, and the craft cocktail revolution was ignited. Dave Wondrich was at the center of that movement. When we finally captured Dave for a conversation, he spoke of those early days and his accidental debut as a cocktail writer.
When I started writing about drinks, it was at the very end of 1999. I got a phone call from my friend Josh Mack, who was working for Hearst Media, right? Hearst Magazines. And he said, I have kind of a weird project for you. And it involved editing an old cocktail book that of Esquire's for the web. And I started doing it. And this old Esquire book had little essays for some of the drinks, just a little paragraph of racy Esquire-style prose. It was from 1949. And I liked those, and so I wrote a few more of them for some of the other important drinks. And I got a call, and it said, we like those. Can you do one of those every week for the website? Because we need content. And I said, sure. And suddenly, you know, I was a cocktail expert. I'd always liked cocktails going back to, I was a musician in my early 20s, and I could only afford to drink in old man bars, so I drank a lot of very dry martinis. And so I knew a little bit about it, but I really didn't know that much.
I suspect that it must have been in that general time warp that all of the fantastic, great cocktailians came together at that one perfect time.
Yeah, it was really funny. I started writing this online column. I didn't know that there was going to be a movement out of this. At the time, I was making cocktails at home, and we wanted to make Sazeracs. And I went to this was before the internet. So I went to every grocery store, high-end grocery store in New York looking for Peychaud's bitters. And usually they'd say no. And sometimes they'd say, oh, I think it's in the back. And I'd go in the back and there'd be the bitters shelf and there'd just be Angostura and an empty space. So they had just finally left the market. And we were stumped because we really wanted to make Sazeracs. And then Emeril came into the restaurant, an American place where Karen, my wife, was working. And Karen told him about this, our project. And 2 days later, a package shows up at our door with two huge bottles of Peychaud's, courtesy of Emeril. And I will love that man till my grave.
God bless you, Emeril.
Yeah, thank you, Emeril. You are a gent and a lovely man. And so we were making Sazeracs up in New York, and nobody was making Sazeracs, you know. You couldn't get the stuff.
No.
And now it's like, oh, my God. I don't even know where to start.
Almost passé.
Yeah, you don't even know where to start. We had no inkling that there would be new bars opening only to make craft cocktails.
Was there a bar when you went, really? This is really happening?
Well, Milk and Honey in New York, which had opened right around the time I started writing, but I hadn't heard of them yet because it was pretty underground. And there were a couple others, you know, Angel's Share also in New York. I went to London and I met Dale DeGroff there because he was consulting.
Oh my goodness, that must have been quite a moment.
This was one of the greatest weeks of my life. I have to say, it was maybe 2001, early in the year, and I'd been writing for a couple years for Esquire, and Jonathan Downey, who owns a lot of bars in London and is a real character. He's pretty straightforward, let's say.
Yeah.
Honest, frank.
Outspoken.
Outspoken, yes. He's one of those types. Anyway, he was the English columnist for English Esquire, the drink columnist, and he liked my stuff. And he said, you should come over. And I came over, and he was opening Milk and Honey London, and Dale DeGroff was doing the training. And he basically had Dale and I pal around for a week in London.
Goodness.
And I had not met Dale before, but I'd, you know, heard of him and respected his work. And it turns out we got along very well, and we had a blast. We went to Groucho's Club. We went to the Colony Room, the famous social club that's where all the modern British artists paid their tabs and paintings. And they didn't have a cocktail strainer. The guy used his fingers. It was filthy. We did all this stuff, and we just had a blast. That was one of the just an unimaginably fun week.
Are you amazed at the extreme number of craft distilleries and this boutique sort of extreme moment we're in?
I'm amazed. Sometimes, frankly, I'm appalled.
Why?
Because for every 10 master distillers, there are about 3 distillers. You know, they're about 3 people who know what they're doing, and a bunch of other people who are kind of floundering around and making something that tastes vaguely like gin. You know, I tasted something just now. I was over at one of my favorite bars on earth, Two Jugs, with one of my favorite bartenders on earth, Paul Gustings. You know, he's an old friend of mine. Just to interrupt for a second, I knew I amounted to something in life when my bartender came and picked me up at the airport.
When
I landed in New Orleans, you know, Paul came and got me once, and I was like, okay, I have done something with my life. But Paul had me taste this liqueur that somebody had sent him, and it was just appallingly bad. You know, it happens. I mean, that's part of it, too, but there are some people who are great.
Dave, you walked in this afternoon and immediately said to me, ah, look, there's a punch bowl. Let's make some punch. Where does your absolute punch mania spring from?
It springs from being a very lazy person. I will tell you that. Because when I started writing about drinks, suddenly I'm the drinks guy among my friends, and we'd have parties, and I'd be sitting there shaking cocktails for everyone. And so if you stand behind a counter with a cocktail shaker, even your best friends turn into monsters.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
We're suddenly thirsty.
Yeah, and it's like, can you do that? You know, it's like, I don't like what you're making. Can you make me this while I don't have the stuff? What do you mean you don't have the stuff? It's like, that's, you know, and suddenly you're taken aback. It's like, wait, you're my friend. You're over here at my house. You know, I don't have to make you anything, really.
Really? I mean, I can give you a bottle of Coke,
yeah.
And there's some rum over there.
Yeah, and you can help yourself.
Good luck with that.
So I learned early on, it's like, this is not great. Let me look at these weird, corny old punch recipes. And I'd look at the amounts of water that went into them. And I'd say, that's way too much water. And I'd leave most of the water out. And you know what happened? There's people wandering on the lawn with no pants on. I mean, it's slaughter of the innocents.
Slaughter of the innocents.
Oh, my God. We had some days. Oof. And finally, I learned, just put the damn water in, you know.
Absolutely.
I like getting people a little more drunk than they were counting on. Not a lot more. I don't like them, you know, throwing up and falling over. But I like people suddenly to be just a little more tipsy than they thought, because that's when the real fun starts. It's in that area right there.
That,
you know?
Golden moment.
Yeah, that golden moment when everybody's just suddenly like, woo, this is fun.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it's a little bit of chaos that I enjoy.
And I, as I understand it, you've taken to talking about drinking like a pirate. So how do you drink like a pirate, Dave? What's up with you and the pirates?
Well, the pirates, what everybody thinks, they were just swigging rum out of the bottle. There's one record of a pirate ship capturing a Anglican priest on board, and they pressed the priest into service to be their punch maker. They drank punch. Thank you very much. You know, they pirates tried to do the best of everything when they could get it. You know, and raw rum, okay, but we can drink punch. You know, we can take sugar from people and limes from people just as easily as we could take casks of rum. And wouldn't we rather have punch? You know.
I'm very curious if Dave Wondrich drinks seasonally.
I make a lot of Manhattans and things like that in the winter. I write. I work at home mostly. And I'll always come down at the end of the day from my office and mix a cocktail for Karen and me. And it's, I don't usually work from recipes. I just look at what we have. And it's usually something kind of in the martini and Manhattan family, you know, something, some vermouth and some spirits, because it's before dinner and it's a little bit of an aperitif. And in the summer, though, I sort of switch to daiquiris and things like that.
There's always someone who's ready to ask you questions like, what would your last meal be? Who would your dining companions be? Dave Wondrich, I would be remiss if I let you out of here without asking you, if you could have only one last cocktail on this earth, what would you pick?
Well, it's funny. I mean, when I left my job at Esquire after 17 years last year, they asked me to do an exit column. They asked that question. And I said it would be a sidecar with Gaz Regan at Harry's Bar in Paris. And, you know, I'm not going to change that answer. Because the first time I was at Harry's, I was with Gaz, or the artist formerly known as Gary, and he's an old and dear friend of mine. And we were sitting there, and it's an old bar that was transported from the U.S. So it's an old American style cocktail bar, and the sun was slanting in through the little window behind us, and the bar had been polished by hands for over 100 years, and the bartender was using a beautiful silver shaker and just shook us up a couple rounds of sidecars, and I don't know, that was the best drink in the world at the time. And, you know, I would go with that again.
This is such a thrill. I've been waiting a long time.
I'm glad we could do this.
Me too. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you so much.
Writer and cocktail virtuoso, Dave Wondrich. When we come back from a short break, we'll visit Shreveport's Zocolo Neighborhood Eatery, where bartender Aulden Morgan is serving up cocktails and shots infused with the hottest pepper in the world, the Carolina Reaper. Stay tuned. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Rouse's Markets and from Ralph Brennan's Redfish Grill. From dock to pot, offering 9 varieties of fresh Gulf fish daily. Lunch, dinner, and private events at 115 Bourbon Street in the French Quarter. cocktail scene in Shreveport-Bossier continues expanding, so does the innovation behind bars. For years, bartender Aulden Morgan at Zocolo Neighborhood Eatery in Shreveport has been transforming their cocktail menu into one of the most unique in the region, offering drinks with fresh and local juices and a diverse array of quirky infused liquors.
Go ahead and just lead the way here.
The Louisiana Eats crew dropped by Zocolo one weekday afternoon to meet Aulden and try a sampling of his latest libations.
So at this time, the craft cocktail scene is really in its infancy here in Shreveport, as I understand it. So when people come into the bar here, do they think it's time for a gin and tonic and you sort of turn them around?
It's usually kind of a turnaround thing. Like they'll order something, or usually they're going to be a vodka drinker or a gin drinker. Or they love beer or something, and then we'll kind of just add on top of that. I'll be like, well, I'll try something fresh like cucumber with your gin and tonic, or a little bit of ginger. Or most of the time I'll just throw them a drink and just, here, try that one. Yeah, and then if they like it, they like it, and they'll come back for it. It's always hit and miss, add a little bit more of this, add a little less than this. It's always a learning experience behind a cocktail.
Tell us about some of the creations that you have come up with. What are some of the surprising cocktails for the Shreveport scene?
We have a great craft beer here in Shreveport. It's called a Great Raft. And I'm friends with a lot of those guys, and we kind of were the first people to have their beer on tap, and I figured it'd be really cool to do a beer cocktail with their beer and do kind of what we do here, too. The first one I did was Cathead Vodka. It's kind of pecan in flavor, and they had a really nice Saison out at the time that kind of had that lemon honey flavor to it, and I thought pecan and lemon and honey would go really well together, and kind of just shook that up and added a little bit of that Saison on top of it. Then next after that would probably be an Artini competition that we do every year here in Shreveport or Bossier at the Horseshoe Casino. And it's kind of just a martini competition of who has the most different or most delicious martini. And I started to kind of go out of the box with that. And for some reason I thought dandelions and thought I shot myself in the foot on that one as it's so hard to find dandelions. But I ended up meeting a couple of people who that forage.
What did you infuse the dandelions in? What did you do? How did you make the drink?
Well, we roasted them for a little while, kind of give them like a little nutty flavor. Because dandelions have a lot of different flavors, actually. The root kind of tastes like real earthy, like a mushroom or a truffle or something. And then the leaves trying to be a honeysuckle flavor to them. So I just kind of mixed it with local honey to try to add on to that nuttiness. And just made a simple syrup out of it, trying to boil them down and added sugar, equal parts sugar and water, and a little bit of honey to kind of give it that extra little dimension.
Well, would you take us in the back and show us some of the science experiments you're cooking up back there?
Yeah, I sure can. We actually have a new cocktail list about to come out, so there's a lot of things back there right now we're working on.
Well, let's go see.
Sitting on two shelves, dozens of jars and bottles were filled with infusions in a variety of colors. Amber, peach, yellow, and brown.
Always something new. I have a peanut butter infused bourbon for my trying to play on a brandy milk punch, trying to give it more of a dessert feel. We do a ginger infused vodka, which we're on the shelf right now. We use that one for a kind of an Asian pear and ginger martini, kind of like a lemon drop, but with just pears and ginger. Orange infused vodka, lavender, cucumber, vanilla. All sorts of stuff. Rosemary simple syrup, we use in our tea.
On the bottom shelf, one bottle stood out to me. The only one that came with its own warning label written in Sharpie. It's hot. This, Aulden explained, was the Carolina Reaper vodka.
That Carolina Reaper pepper is one of the hottest pepper in the world right now.
Yeah, it exceeded the ghost pepper.
Over twice as hot on the Scoville unit as a ghost pepper, so. Carolina Reaper pepper, it only takes about 2 to 3 hours to sit in vodka. It's actually the quickest infusion we do here. The pepper is just so hot, it really only takes about a third of a pepper to make about a gallon of it, too.
And where do you get those peppers from?
I had to special order them from there's a handful of people that grow them in Carolina where it originated from. The last batch I bought I actually got from Australia.
Wow.
Tried to figure out a way to just wow factor, and that was my first kind of infusion that I ever did. And I was like, that'd be great for a Bloody Mary, and then it ended up people taking bets behind the bar of who didn't drink it or how hot the Bloody Mary was. And
It wouldn't make sense to visit Zocolo without sampling their most famous item on the menu. But I have to admit I had my reservations.
I'm not going to play.
Poppy, come on. Poppy, definitely.
This looks like a boy's game to me. I'm not playing.
I get forced to take them all the time. People will dare it, and they'll be like, well, if the bartender's not going to do one, I'm definitely not going to do one.
Fortunately, our fearless roving reporter Chris J was on hand and agreed to join Alden in a shot of the potent liquid.
Is this in the vein of what doesn't kill you makes you better?
I would say so, yes.
I'm not even going to give you a full shot because I don't want to kill you.
Tell me, will you tell me what exactly I'm in for here? I mean, how much pain?
You're in for about a good solid 5 minutes of just heat in your...
Okay, Chris. Don't worry.
Just down the hatch, right, Alden?
We're here to back you up if anything bad happens.
Just get it down.
I'm afraid I'm going to do it and you're not going to do it.
I mean, I'll do it.
Okay, all right. On three. All right. One, two, three.
All right.
Cheers. Oh, my God.
And don't be surprised if you didn't talk.
But it's a really deep, searing pain.
Here come the hiccups for me.
Well, you're getting a little flushed. You're looking a little flushed.
Yeah. It hurts like hell.
Is the pain moving down your esophagus?
Yes. And that's actually really the part that hurts. My mouth is not that bad, but my esophagus feels like it needs to be replaced. I feel like you only live once, and when else? I'm never going to drink another Carolina Reaper pepper-infused vodka. I'm never going to have that chance again. So I figured I'd do it. But God, I'm in pain.
At least we didn't do a whole one.
Love is a burning thing. And it makes a fiery ring.
Bartender Aulden Morgan and our roving reporter Chris J at Zocolo Neighborhood Eatery in Shreveport.
I fell into a ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire.
My name is Scott Blackwell. I am the founder and head distiller at High Wire Distilling Company in Charleston, South Carolina.
Scott Blackwell seems to fit neatly into a nursery rhyme. You know, the one about the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker? Scott is, amongst other things, a baker, a coffee roaster, and most recently, a master distiller. When we spoke to Scott, his natural curiosity about making food and drink was unmistakable. I asked him about his transition to craft distilling.
Well, the whole High Wire thing is the umbrella brand. That's the distillery. And we wanted something. My wife and I are both fans of old typography and sort of that pre-prohibition, turn of the century, vaudeville, circus, magic act, you know, when they had the traveling shows and the big hand-painted canvas posters for all the sideshows and stuff like that. My wife also knew that as a very embarrassed or insecure middle schooler, I had this fascination with magicians. And I had a lot of my books that I'd saved from my childhood of magic posters, et cetera, et cetera. So when we started thinking about gin, you know, it's kind of got a British old, you know, sort of there again, fits in with that turn of the century, 1800s era. And also there's sort of a sleight of hand when it comes to gin because everybody will tell you what botanicals are in there, but they don't really tell you like the formula, you know? So there's like, ooh, I think people will taste our gin and go, ooh, I think I taste cinnamon in there. Is there cinnamon in here? And it's like, no, you know, there's always, so it was just a fun way to approach gin, I think, and it works. You know, we call it botanical because we use botanicals in there, but it's sort of a, you know, classic, for me, what classic gin might have tasted like back then. And then the barrel rested has just been in a barrel.
Yeah.
You know.
How long does it sit?
About 6 months. We don't want it to get like over oaked. We use new oak for that. So it gives you more of a, and you know, sort of a caramelized baked orange kind of flavor. it rounds off the juniper and then the cardamom in there, that the wood picks it up and kind of gives it this holiday spice flavor. So it makes it just more, it makes it interesting and different.
So how in the world did you happen upon sorghum to make your whiskey? And how in the world did you find your sorghum on a Mennonite farm in central Tennessee?
Well, while I had the bakery, gluten-free became a bigger thing in the baked world, especially. And I started playing around with flours, and one of the flours I happened on was sorghum flour. And that's, I think, been always a gift of mine, is curiosity and obsession. And so that led to this sorghum obsession. And I started looking for farms around the country. And most of the farms that I met, you know, the farmers that I was meeting were just like family farms, and they were Mennonites and Amish. And because your average farmer, they're growing row crops. You know, they're growing corn and soybeans. So I'm at a festival in South Carolina. There's a guy named John T. Edge, and John T. and I have known each other for years. I was a guest chef years ago for a SFA symposium. We're walking. We hadn't seen each other in a few years. We're walking along, and he says, "So you're getting into distilling now?" And I said, "Yeah." And he goes, "Well, that's cool." And at this point, I'd never distilled anything. He said, "Well, what are you going to distill?" And I said, "I don't know. Whiskey, gin, rum. You know, I mean, I'm just like, I don't know. I need to do homework. I don't know what, you know." And he says, "Well, what about sorghum?" And I'm like, "Huh." And then probably 6 weeks later, called these Mennonites that I knew and got some sorghum and fermented it. It smelled completely different, which I knew it would, from corn. Distilled it, and as it came off the still, it smelled like apples and just really fragrant floral notes. And I was like, "Huh, okay, so this clear stuff coming off is not just booze. It's actually systemic flavor from what you started with."
What did the Mennonites think about you taking their sorghum and making liquor out of it?
You know, I wondered that at first, and I was a little hesitant to tell them what we were going to do with it, but I thought, you know, full transparency, I'll tell them. One of the brothers came down to Charleston because he was so curious over, and it's like a 8-hour drive to see the sorghum being made. So he sipped on it, but he didn't drink it. You know, you just take, but I think as a farmer, he's very passionate and proud of what they grow. Uh-huh. And I think seeing that in the distillate and tasting that was, I think it's an intriguing thing. It's like preserved forever. In liquid form. They've actually been pretty cool. I gave them a bottle and they took it back, and it's probably sitting on their mantle or something like that.
Something that really surprised me also, your Southern Amaro liqueur. Now, forgive my ignorance, but I am not aware of a lot of American-made Amaro. Is that pretty unusual?
Yeah, I mean, I think Amaros are definitely growing in the United States. I wanted something that was regionally specific. And what I was seeing from a couple of other the Amaro makers, they're delicious, but they're based more on traditional recipes. And then I remembered going out with this forager during a thing called Cook It Raw that happened up in our area. And he made some tea from this stuff called Yaupon. And Yaupon holly, it's not like a typical holly bush, but it's, you know, kind of looks like an oak leaf type thing. It's got a little serrated edge. And it grows along the coast of South Carolina, grows a little bit in Georgia on the coast and Florida. It likes warm, you know, kind of wet tropical conditions. And then it probably grows along, you know, down in Louisiana, southern Louisiana. I know it grows along the lower Texas. It's the only place in the world that this plant grows. And it's the only native caffeinated plant in North America. And Yaupon is a Catawba word, an Indian word. They used to eat the leaves, chew the leaves. When you steep them, they make a sort of a herbaceous green tea. And it's the cousin of yerba mate out of South America. So I thought that could be kind of cool. Nobody's ever heard of that, I bet. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what that would taste like macerated in alcohol. It doesn't have tannins, so you can leave it and let it steep for days and it doesn't get acrid like tannins do, but it does have a bittering component, so it gets bitter, but it's different than, say, gentian. And we also had a the only tea plantation in North America that just happens to be 20 minutes from the distillery on Wabamaw Island. It's an old Lipton plant, and they started out years ago in the 1700s with trying to grow tea in our area. And this tea plantation sort of stuck out on this island. So I thought, well, I'll use black tea, yopon, and then I use this peel from a Dancy tangerine, which is the grandfather of all tangerines in North America. It's kind of comes out around the holidays, and fresh mint. So we just take the whole stalk, you know, cut the roots off, mint, everything, throw it in and let it macerate. And what we've produced is like a medium bodied, very herbaceous. You've got the mint, you've got the citrus, and you've got the bitter, and you've got some like very subtle sweet tea hints in the background. And that's where the southern part comes in, because there's just like a little bit of this sweet tea flavor. And, you know, it's cool. It's different. It's completely something new to the market. One thing that I'll say about all of this that I feel is important and is the backbone, becoming the backbone of our business, is agriculture is a key component to what we're doing. And through sorghum, the experiments with the Amaro, and then a watermelon brandy, we make a rum agricole. We're the only, you know, we're one of two in the U.S. that make an agricole. So we make, I think, our whiskeys especially, and our brandy and agricole, things like that, are products with a sense of place. And I think that's important in this world of distilling.
I couldn't agree more. I'm very fascinated by your whole point of view, and I'm really, really, really glad that we got to have this conversation. So thanks for making the time.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It's great. Yeah, it's been fun.
From Charleston, South Carolina, that was Scott Blackwell of High Wire Distilling. What does that designation, craft distillery, really mean? Stay tuned, and we'll solve that mystery when we come right back. Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, and from French Market Coffee. French Market Coffee's premium blended beans are locally roasted in small batches, creating a coffee that can only be called New Orleans Bold. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. What does that designation, craft distillery, really mean? The non-governmental American Distilling Institute, founded in 2003, defines craft spirits as the products of an independently owned distillery with maximum annual sales of 52,000 cases of liquor, physically distilled and bottled on site at the distillery. The Institute is a voluntary, privately owned organization who awards their certification through a relatively easy process of filling out a form to get your craft distillery sticker. So it's no surprise that the relatively new industry is running into some issues. Lawsuits have cropped up in objection to confusing or misleading terminology on spirits labels. The concept of volume dictating craft status is changing.
it's inevitable that federal and state governments will have a hand in regulating what it means to be a craft distilled spirit. But the bottom line for you is, do you like the taste? Thanks to American craft distillers, there's lots of good, carefully crafted tastes for mixing in your next cocktail. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats.
I am Tom Bulleit. I am the founder of Bulleit Bourbon.
If you've ever considered a career change, you've no doubt heard the same advice. Don't quit your day job till you've got something else lined up. 30 years ago, Tom Bulleit was a lawyer with dreams of becoming an entrepreneur.
Well, as I tell young entrepreneurs, if you have a successful business, you're an entrepreneur. If you're not, I probably can't say what you are. It would be inappropriate. So people will say, well, how do I be an entrepreneur? And I say, well, marry someone with a good job.
That someone happened to be Betsy, his wife, since 1987. Not long after their nuptials, Tom was able to make the move from practicing law to distilling Bulleit Bourbon. And thanks to its quick rise in popularity, he hasn't looked back since. Today, you can find Bulleit's iconic canteen-shaped bottles in bars all over the world. When we spoke with Tom, he explained what propelled him to bite the bullet and pursue a full-time career in whiskey.
I think it all began when I was working between school terms. I would work either for family or for friends or in Louisville or Bardstown at the distilleries and really fell in love with the business at that point. Always wanted to do it. And after I finished the University of Kentucky, after some years, my father, who went to Notre Dame, said to me, Tom, your undergraduate work has been abysmal. And it was so abysmal, I didn't know what the word meant. I said, thanks, Dad. I said, I'm going to be a master distiller. He said, you'll be going in the military like everyone else, and then you will be a lawyer. And I thought, well, that's pretty interesting. So after some training, core school, field medical school, I'm off to Vietnam with the 1st Marine Division in 1967-68.
Wow. And how did that shape your future?
Well, I think it shaped my future dramatically. In one way, I was an undisciplined undergraduate, and I did go to law school afterwards and was a good law student.
And what made you decide in 1987 to take this big shift in life?
Well, I really wanted to do this all of my life. Our family's been in and out of the business for six generations, and it just sort of ripened at that time.
Tell me a little bit about how you learned about your great-great-grandfather, how that inspired you, and who Augustus Bulleit really was.
We know some about him. A lot of the history is oral history. We know that he immigrated from France, came to New Orleans here in the early 1800s, lived here for a while, and then traveled up the Mississippi and the Ohio Rivers to the Louisville area of Kentucky, distilled between maybe 1830 and 1860. And then ultimately, maybe a couple times a year, he would bring barrels down those rivers. Of course, he spoke French and had commercial contacts here, and would sell, age it by the mile. I guess when he got it here, they would sell it, and then travel back to Kentucky, which would have been a various arduous journey during
yes.
that period of our history. And in 1860, he did not return.
He yes. came to New Orleans, but he didn't make it back.
We don't know how far he made it. He could have made it to Memphis, could have made it to Natchez, could have turned the wrong way and gone to St. Louis. We you know, you just don't know, but we know he didn't return. And he had five children. I am descended of one of those children, John Joseph. Descendant of one of those children, and passed down from Augustus to John Joseph to F.A., my grandfather, Francis Aim Bulleit. Needless to say, that did not survive to the next generation. Thomas, my father, and then Thomas, me, and the kids, so six generations.
If one was to drink Bulleit Bourbon today, what might they taste of your great-great-grandfather in it?
Well, I think what they would taste is that it is bourbon. I think the bourbons would have been similar. Particularly, we make a cask-strength bourbon, which is barrel-strength. And his bourbon would have been like that. It would not have been anywhere near as sophisticated, obviously. He would not have been able to control that. It would have been a similar process, but he would not have been able to control the process like we can today and control the consistency. But I think he would have used similar grains. He would not have aged it very long. The color would have come from the barrel, the same thing. They would have been charred because they may have shipped fish to Kentucky, and they would burn that out. Those really the containers, the shipping containers of that era were barrels. I would presume that ours would be tastier, shall I say.
Tom, what is your favorite way to drink your whiskey?
My dad and I would probably sit on the patio. He would laid a stone patio in the back of the house. That's when back in the era when dads knew how to do things. I don't. We would sit there and maybe have bourbon on the rocks. Water is to whiskey as oxygen is to wine. Ice, the same thing. Just going to open it up. Mother would drink a highball, which is add water to the bourbon and on the rocks. My aunt was a Catholic nun. She drank it straight. I guess she gave herself a dispensation, I guess. I don't know. And then the cocktail culture, which has been a huge growth driver for our brand, which is really a cult brand on premises. I've probably tried thousands of cocktails over the years, and I've never had one that I didn't think was tasted good and was well made. My wife drinks BLTs. Betsy drinks Bulleit Bourbon, a little lemon, like a wedge of lemon we throw in our iced teas, and tonic, which you wouldn't think to put together, and is a delicious drink. It's very nice.
If you were to sit down today with your great-great-grandfather, what do you suppose the two of you would have to talk about?
Well, I think I would ask him, I would say, why didn't you come home? I think
that would be the first question.
So, where have you been? It's okay to come back. Now, I would be speaking as one of his descendants. I'm not sure if his wife would ask the same question. She may say, well, we've missed you some. So I think we would have a nice conversation about making whiskey and what a great tradition that had been. If you reflect, in 1800, there were 2,000 stills in Kentucky. It was a function of our agrarian society. If you grew grains, you would feed the family, feed the livestock, and the grains would either rot or you'd make whiskey. So it was really a function of daily life at that point. I think he would obviously be amazed to see how the industry has evolved with something that really started as a basic element of farming.
Since 1987 until today, what are the things that have surprised you about the industry, about what you've seen? Have you had any moments where you've said, oh, really, now?
Well, I think lots of those moments. I think, for instance, when I brought Augustus's recipe back in 1987, that was in the middle of the vodka craze. I mean, bourbons were dramatically in the decline. At that point, scotches had usually been sold as blends, but then all of a sudden in the late 80s, early 90s, into the mid-90s, they started marketing single malts. And straight bourbons are essentially single malts. So everybody really sort of upped their game at that point in the American brown goods distilling industry. I think we all have been, from Jimmy Russell to Elmer T. Lee and all of the great giants, some of whom have passed now, like Lincoln Henderson and Bill Samuels, my dear friend Bill Samuels. I think we were all surprised at how bourbons have come back. I think certainly in my life, surprises have been really the function that I'm not dead yet and I've fallen uphill a lot. When we got together with Seagram's, when we partnered with Seagram's, and then when our current partner, Diageo, is a wonderful company, bought a lot of Seagram's and we're with them now. So I think Some of the moments I don't have to tell Betsy. My wife is a financial advisor, stockbroker. She tells me to say financial advisor. But I remember her asking me about every 3 months. She would say, now, Tom, tell me Tell me again how this is all going to work. I've calculated that it will take you practicing law until you're 117 and a half just pay the interest on the loans here. So I don't have to answer that anymore, which is nice.
That's grand. So many people in this industry got caught by surprise with the craze for rye whiskey. Tell me about why rye whiskey is so identifiable with Bulleit.
Well, for a couple of reasons. We have grown with the cocktail movement. I call these bartenders and the mixologists our partners in chemistry. One of the philosophy of our brands is to defer to them. I want to respond to them. We make straight aged bourbons and ryes. And our bourbon whiskey, my great-great-grandfather's recipe that I brought back, was 2/3 corn, 1/3 rye. And that's about maybe twice plus as much rye as any of the other bourbons. So our San Francisco bartenders love that product, and they said, Tom, we see rye coming on because a lot of the old cocktails call for rye whiskey. You've got a big footprint in your bourbon with the rye recipe. Why don't you bring us a full rye? And that's exactly what we did. We started early on, and then in 2011 brought out our rye whiskey, which is 95% rye, 5% malted barley. It's a great, well, now it has become really the definitive product in the category. I think we have maybe a half, maybe a 50% market share. The turn of the century, 2003, 2004, 2005, we started that project very seriously. It was almost like a hot tip from the bartenders and made a good amount of rye. So we were, and I think that certainly attributes to some of our growth, we're able to stay in stock. And it's a great product at a good price.
If you were to take the long look with the way that spirits change and tastes change, what do you think the future of bourbon is?
Well, I think the future is bright. It's one of the baseline categories. When you mix a drink with bourbon, you configure it so it pushes forward what is there and enhances what is there. You live in the world of dining, of everything from pretty good to fine dining, and it would be like saying, "Well, do you think wine is a phase?" Well, it's. Wine is here to stay, obviously, and I think the cocktail culture is here to stay. And the bourbon industry will be a component of that always.
Tom Bulleit, founder of Bulleit Bourbon. That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Have you missed an episode of Louisiana Eats? Hear today's show or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com, where you can also subscribe to the podcast and take us with you wherever you go. If you love Louisiana Eats, let others know and help like-minded Louisiana food lovers find our show by leaving a review on iTunes. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, French Market Coffee, and Rouse's Markets. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau, and from Dickie Brennan's Steakhouse, a local New Orleans steakhouse serving prime beef in New Orleans' French Quarter. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner, Sarah Holtz, and Reggie Morris, and to our business manager and social media maven, Maddie Mulladew. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studios at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. Don't forget to find our recipes and see what we're up to at poppytooker.com. You can check us out on Instagram and Facebook, too. I'm Poppy Tooker. Louisiana Eats is a production of Poppy Tooker Broadcasting.